Hi friends, and welcome back to Easy Dentistry. Friends, please subscribe to our channel and share the videos with your friends and share knowledge. Today we are going to study the second part of cementum, which is cementogenesis. Earlier we have in the first part of cementum we have studied about the general features. Students, if you have not watched the first part, I recommend you all to first watch the first parts, because many terminologies which are used in today's lecture are explained in the first part. So without wasting any time, let's start with today's lecture. In today's lecture, we will be studying about the cementodentinal junction, the cementoenamel junction, the functions of cementum and cementogenesis. Now let's begin with the first topic, that is cementodentinal junction. The cementodentinal junction is the junction between the cementum and the dentin. In permanent teeth, this junction is straight, while in the deciduous teeth it is scalloped. But in the both types of teeth, this cementodentinal junction is very, very firm. Now, if we see the cementodentinal junction under electron microscope, it appears as a wide band. If this is the cementum, this is the dentin, this wide zone is the cementodentinal junction. It consists of ground substance, which is shown by black dots, collagen fibers shown by green bundles, and some water molecules shown by blue dots. This configuration of the cementodentinal junction gives stiffness and thus help in redistribution of forces to the alveolar bone. Now, in some cases, between the cementum and the dentin, there is a layer which is structureless. This layer is called as the hyaline layer or intermediate cementum layer. It is mostly seen in the apical two-third part of premolars and molars. It is believed that this hyaline layer is formed due to the Hertwig's epithelial cells, which are entrapped in fastly formed cementum and dentin. While others, they believe that this hyaline layer is dentinal in origin, but the exact origin of the hyaline layer is unknown. Now, let us study the cementoenamel junction. The junction between the enamel of the tooth and the cementum of the root is called as cementoenamel junction. Now, this cementoenamel junction is variable. In 30% of the teeth, the enamel and the cementum, they meet each other in a sharp line. In 10% of the teeth, the enamel of the tooth and the cementum of the root, they do not meet with each other, and at the junction of the enamel and the cementum, the reduced enamel epithelium is present between the two tissues. Now let us see how this happens. During the process of root formation, the cervical part of the enamel organ, which is shown by red line, is the Hertwig's epithelial root sheath. When the first layer of dentin is formed, this epithelial root sheath is delayed from its separation from the dentin. So, no cementoenamel junction is formed, and the zone of root is devoid of cementum and is covered by the reduced enamel epithelium. Now, in 60% of the teeth, the cementum of the root, it overlaps the enamel. Now, how does this happen? The cervical portion of the enamel organ, that is the Hertwig epithelial root sheath, it sometimes degenerates earlier. It degenerates earlier, as a result of which the connective tissue of the surrounding dental follicle comes in contact with this dentin, and a layer of cementum is formed upon the enamel, and thus the cementum, it overlaps the enamel. This cemento-enamel junction is a very important question asked in exams. So to remember this, let me tell you an example. Suppose cat and elephant are good friends. So 30% of the times, the cat and the elephant will meet each other, greet each other and go away. That is, the cementum and the enamel meet each other in a sharp line in 30% teeth. As the cement, the cat and the elephant are good friends, only 10% of the time they may fight with each other. And in this case, the cementum and the enamel do not meet each other. Only 10% cases. Most of the times, that is 60% of the times, the cat and the elephant would play with each other and even the cat would climb upon the elephant. And in this case, the cementum, it overlaps the enamel. Some of the time, the students get confused that whether the cementum overlaps the enamel or the enamel overlaps the cementum. Considering the example of cat and elephant, we can say that only the cat can climb over the elephant. So the cementum can climb over the enamel. The elephant cannot climb over the cat, so the enamel will never ever overlap the cementum. Hope this is clear to you now, friends. Now, what is the case in the deciduous teeth? In the deciduous teeth, the enamel of the crown and the cementum of the root, in most of the cases, they meet each other in a sharp line. And the second most common condition is that the cementum, it may overlap the enamel. Now let us see what are the functions of the cementum. The functions of the cementum are three. First is the anchorage, second is the adaptation, and third is the repair. Let us see one by one in detail. In the first diagram, we can see that the green layer, which is the layer of cementum, is present on the root. And it acts as a medium for the attachment of the red color PDL fibers to the tooth socket. And thus, the cementum helps in anchoring the tooth to the alveolar bone socket. The second function of the cementum is adaptation. If there are heavy occlusal forces which causes wear of the occlusal surface of the tooth, in response to these occlusal forces, cementum is deposited on the apical area of the root, and this is an adaptive feature of enamel. The third function of enamel is repair. If there is an injury to the root in the form of pathological fracture or resorption, cellular cementum is deposited in this area of injury, and thus it demonstrates the repair function of the cementum. Now let us study the important topic, the cementogenesis. The process of cementum formation is called as cementogenesis. In the lecture of Hertwig's epithelial root sheath, we have studied how the Hertwig's epithelial root sheath is formed and its detailed structure. Students, please brush up your knowledge about Hertwig's epithelial root sheath by watching that video again. Now, in that lecture, we have studied that on the coronal end of the Hertwig's epithelial root sheath, which is shown by red band, the first layer of dentin is formed. As this first layer of dentin is formed, the Hertwig's epithelial root sheath, it migrates in apical direction, giving rise to more dentin. And this process continues till the apical end of the root is reached. Now what happens? When the Hertwig's epithelial root sheath, it migrates in an apical direction, there is break in the continuity of this root sheath. When the root sheath breaks down, the connective tissue cells of the surrounding dental follicle, they come into contact with the underlying dentin. Once this contact occurs, the cells of the connective tissue, they get differentiated into cementoblasts. And these cementoblast cells then deposit a layer of cementum on the dentin. Now, it is also believed that some of the cells of the Hertwig's epithelial root sheath, they migrate away into the connective tissue of the dental sac and form cementoblast, and these cementoblasts also deposit the cementum. Now we have studied that the cementoblast may have two origins. First origin may be the connective tissue of the dental follicle, and the second origin is the Hertwig's epithelial root sheath. The cementoblast, which are formed from the dental follicle, mainly gives rise to the cellular intrinsic fiber cementum, while those derived from the Hertwig's epithelial root sheath gives rise to the acellular extrinsic fiber cementum. The cementoblasts, which are derived from the dental follicle, they resemble the osteoblast, and the cementoblasts, which are derived from the Hertwig's epithelial root sheath, they do not resemble the osteoblast. Also, the dental follicle derived cementoblasts have parathormone receptor on it, while those derived from the Hertwig's epithelial root sheath do not have the parathormone receptor. Now let us study the development of cellular cementum. How does the cellular cementum is formed? The cellular cementum is formed in two stages. In the stage 1 is the earlier stage, and stage 2 is the late stage. In the earlier stage, extrinsic fibers are very few. The red lines are the extrinsic fibers. And amongst these extrinsic fibers, the intrinsic fibers are randomly arranged. As the process continues and the late stage is reached, these extrinsic fibers are thickened. These are represented by broad red lines, and the intrinsic fibers, they encircle these extrinsic fibers, which are shown by the green lines. So also, how the cells are entrapped in the cellular cementum. We have seen the structure of the cementoblast. It contains of a body and numerous processes extending from its cell surface. The cementum secretion occurs from various regions of these cementoblasts. This is called as multipolar mode of secretion. As the cementum formation continues, more and more cementum is laid down in a very fast speed, and these cementoblasts, they get entrapped in this cementum matrix. So if we study the microscopic feature of the cellular cementum, we can see thickened extrinsic fibers and intrinsic fibers, which encircle the extrinsic fibers, and the cementoblast cells entrapped in this matrix. Now let us study the development of acellular cementum. After the first layer of dentin is laid down by the enamel organ, the Hertwig's epithelial root sheath, which is shown by the red band, they release certain molecules. These are the GLA proteins, osteonectin, osteopontin, fibrillar collagen, bone cello protein, and these molecules gives rise to the unmineralized form of cementum, which is the cementoid. Once this unmineralized cementum is formed, calcium and phosphate are deposited on this cementum, and it becomes mineralized. How does this calcium and phosphate deposition occurs? The molecules which are released by the Hertwig's epithelial root sheath, they attract the calcium ions towards it. And also an important enzyme, alkaline phosphatase, help in mineralization. Thus, the mineralization of the cementum occurs. Now, let us study the final topic, which is cementoid. We have seen that cementogenesis is a rhythmic process. Now, what is cementoid tissue? Cementoid tissue is an unmineralized layer of cementum, and it is most probably seen in the cellular intrinsic fiber cementum. So this is a diagrammatic representation of the root of tooth. The green color is the cementum, and the blue layer on this cementum is the cementoid. If we see this under microscope, we can see this is green color is the cementum, and the blue color layer on the cementum is the cementoid. Now, on the surface of the cementoid, there are cementoblast cells. The red lines are the periodontal ligament fibers. These periodontal ligament fibers, they pass in between the cementoblast and traverses the thickness of the cementoid, and the terminal parts of these periodontal ligament fibers are embedded in the cementum. And these embedded portions of the cementoid are called as Sharpe's fibers. And these Sharpe's fibers help in attachment of the tooth to the bony socket. Now it is the quiz time. Students, please type your answers in the comment box. This exercise is very, very important to self-evaluate yourself. By answering the question, you will come to know whether these videos are really helping you. If some of your answers are wrong, you can anytime go back to the videos and watch them again. The first question is, the structureless layer found between the cementum and dentine is called what? The second question is, the most common type of cemento-enamel junction in permanent teeth is? The third question is, in CIFC, the cementoblasts are derived from what origin? And the final question today is, the uncalcified layer of cementum is called what? The next lecture will be on periodontal ligament. This is a very important chapter. Stay tuned for the next lecture. Subscribe to our channel and happy studying.